Now, for some of us, you know, we had good fathers. Some didn't have such good fathers. And some can't relate to a good father because of their own personal experience. But our Heavenly Father is the best. And He loves us with a love that is so strong and powerful, and He intends every good thing for us. We can certainly not give Him enough praise. But thank you guys for helping us sing that and remind us what a good Father He really is. Now, I'm not sure. Am I coming through a bit loud? Maybe you ought to bring me down a little bit. I'll humble myself and get quieter. Okay? All right. We're going back to the message that we've been sharing. This will be the third in the series, God's Plan for Our Victory Through Multiplication and Addition. And from 2 Peter, grace and peace be multiplied. Multiplication is a great thing because it grows faster. But then he goes on to say, and also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith. So here's the addition part, and this is our part. Now let's do a quick review of the last two messages, and we've just kind of get focused on where we're going today. Remember, God wants us to experience victory. He doesn't want us to be losers. He wants us to be victors, people that experience victory, winners. But you can't have a victory without a battle. You can't win without a contest. You can't overcome without a struggle. And there's no solution without a problem. If a teacher gives you a blank page and says, write the solution down, what are you going to write? If there's no problem, if she says 2 - 2 = then you can put 0. But if there's no problem, you don't have a solution. And so life is made up of battles and contests and struggles and problems, but God wants us to be victorious. And Simon was writing this letter to the Christians, to the believers, and trying to tell them God has provided for them everything we need to be victorious. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and our Savior Jesus, our Lord, as His divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruptionness in the world through lust. What does it mean to have life and godliness? It means the life of Christ and God-likeness is restored in us. Now, the image of God was messed up when Adam and Eve took a wrong turn away from God. And they took on, willfully, they took on the image and the attitude and the actions of the devil. And the serpent that came and tempted Eve, the devil was behind it. And today, the scripture says, be sober, be vigilant, be on guard, be watchful, be always on the lookout, because your enemy, the devil, is going around like a roaring lion looking for whom he may devour. Not he may, because you have to give him permission. You have to let him do it because you can stand against him. God's given us everything to win. He wants us to be like him and to act like him. And that's what he's always tempting us to do. Through bad attitudes, through bad words, through bad actions, through bad thoughts, all of this Satan's trying to get us to be like him, while God is saying, no, I created you in my image. I want you to be like me. And he's the one we should be like. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. But for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. And so God's called us to victory. Now, God has planned for our success and victory by giving us all things that we need to be overcomers. And it's like there's a gift box that God's given to all of us. And he says, open the box. And when you open the box, there's grace, God's unmerited favor. When you look inside, there's peace that we're reconciled and made friends and part of the family of God. And there's promises of God that are exceedingly great and precious to enable us to get a hold of them. It's like a blank check that's already signed by God saying, fill it out, what you need. God has given us great promises so that we can be victorious and we can be overcomers. Everything is promised that we need to escape the corruption that's in the world and to be partakers of the divine nature. Now, if you look at the box again, you might find a note inside. And it says, you must add to these things that I give you in this box. In other words, don't just say, oh, that's it. Okay, don't need to do anything. No, you've got to do some addition. And the addition is our part. He says, so you diligently, what does he say? Giving all diligence. All diligence means to be really pushing, to be striving, to be careful, to work hard at adding to your faith virtue and the virtue knowledge and so on. So let's look at that in the chart form here. Faith is what we have to get into the family of God. And then he says, to your faith add virtue. And then to your virtue knowledge. That's what we're going to focus on today. And then to knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, brotherly kindness, and so on. Brotherly kindness, love. Now, he says, if you don't have these things, that you're blind. You really don't know what God is wanting to do with your life, and it's like you've gone back to the old ways. Virtue, by definition, is moral excellence. It's a morally excellent person is a person who has character that's made up of good values, good virtues. He or she is honest, respectful, courageous, forgiving, loving, and kind. Now, isn't that the kind of people you want to be your friends? People you can trust, people of character, people that aren't going to hurt you, people that are going to love you and be your friend and take care of you. We all want to be that kind of person, and we should. And so God has called us to virtue, to add virtue to our faith, but then it doesn't stop there. To our virtue, we add knowledge. Knowledge. What is knowledge? Knowledge is what you know for sure. Knowledge is not just what you think. Well, I think it. No, that's not knowledge. We can all dream up stuff that's not true. That's not knowledge. It's not just what you believe. Well, I think it's going to be like this. Well, no, that's not knowledge either. And so, well, I just hope so. Well, hope is not good enough. We've got to have knowledge. What is knowledge? Well, it's not just something you heard somebody say. Knowledge is something that's absolute fact. It's truth that you know to be a fact. And God offers true knowledge to the whole world. Jesus said that you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. He said the truth will liberate you if you know the truth. And knowledge is knowing the truth. What is real? What is true? Now, notice what Jesus said again. When he, the Holy Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. In other words, he'll give you the knowledge of the truth. And he's not going to just make up stuff to speak. He's going to speak what is the authority of God to speak. And whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you of things to come. He's saying the Holy Spirit is going to give you knowledge when he comes into your life. And God wants us to add knowledge to our faith and our virtue, and to add knowledge so that we know what we know for sure. And we know that we know it for sure. Okay? So here we go. Evil and wicked people reject the knowledge of the truth. They don't want to know the truth. Their minds are closed to the truth. Unless God works a miracle to open their minds, and they say, oh, okay, I want to know the truth. But most evil people, they don't want the truth. And so here's what the Bible says. Job said this, wherefore do the wicked live? Become old, yet they are mighty in power. Yet they say to God, this is what wicked people say to God. Depart from us, go away. We do not desire the knowledge of your ways. Who is the Almighty that we should serve him? And what profit do we have to pray to him? What's the use talking to that whoever up there? And that's what wicked people say. Go away, leave us alone. We don't want you, God. We don't want to know you. We don't want to know about you. We don't want to talk to you. That's the attitude of so many people in America today that have been brainwashed possibly in the secular education, possibly by parents that don't believe, possibly in the universities or whatever. There is no God. Just, you know, one of the times we're going to show the movie here, many of us have seen it, God's Not Dead. Where the professor tells them all, get out your paper and pencil and write, God is dead. Because we don't want to deal with God here. We don't believe in God here. Well, that's what the wicked say. And that goes on from there. Now, I want to give you an illustration because I'm going to show you some things that's some of the actual verbatim words of some of the wicked people. But first of all, I want you to see something that to me and to righteous people would be very encouraging. Saturday, or maybe it was Friday, President Trump signed a paper declaring today, this Sunday, September 3rd, as a national day of prayer, with special prayer for the people of Texas and for all Americans in our world.
Praise God.
I want you to watch this. And this is actually taken from that when he signed it. And he was surrounded by people, men and women of God, who love God and who are leaders, spiritual leaders in our nation. And he signed this declaration of prayer. But I want you to watch it, and then we're going to look at some responses of some evil people.
From the beginning of our nation, Americans have joined together in prayer during times of great need to ask for God's blessing and God's guidance. When we look across Texas and Louisiana, we see the American spirit of service embodied by countless men and women. Brave first responders have rescued those stranded in drowning cars and rising water, and I have to tell you that I've watched the Coast Guard. Thousands of lives have been saved by our great Coast Guard. They have done incredible work in the most vicious seas that they've seen in many, many years. Families have given food and shelter to those in need. Houses of worship have organized efforts to clean up communities and repair damaged homes. People have never seen anything quite like this. Individuals of every background are striving for the same goal, to aid and comfort people facing devastating losses. As Americans, we know that no challenge is too great for us to overcome. No challenge. We invite all Americans to join us as we continue to pray for those who have lost family members and friends, and for those who are suffering from this great crisis. And behind me, we have faith-based people who are highly respected, and especially so in their communities, where they're not only respected, but they're loved. Evangelical leaders, Christian leaders, many people of faith. And I just want to thank you all for being with us today, because we're going to be signing a day of prayer, and that will be on Sunday. It'll be a very special day, and I don't know when this was done last, but it's been a long time ago. I said it was a long time ago. So I'm going to sign it, and then a few of the folks will say a few words, and Pastor Jeffries will say a prayer for not only the people so affected, so horribly affected by Hurricane Harvey, but for the people of our nation, and in fact, the people of our world.
Commented on the great cooperation that they're experiencing both from the local, state, and federal levels, and they wanted to send their heartfelt gratitude to you and to all of your team for the difference we're making in these people's lives. So thank you for your leadership. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Mr. President, I think it goes without saying, in a moment like this, we all come together as Americans. We all bow to Almighty God. We ask for His grace and His mercy over those who are affected. And we thank you, the Vice President, and your entire team, FEMA, everything you're doing to deploy every resource of government to help those who've been affected. And most of all, Mr. President, we thank you for acknowledging that ultimately it is God who is the source of our unity as Americans. And I thank you for issuing this proclamation today. I appreciate it.
People of faith of all backgrounds know that prayer changes things. And a great work is done by anyone who calls a nation to prayer. We want to give you thanks for calling us to prayer, because no matter where we are, whatever, across whatever spectrum, we know that prayer changes things, and it unites a nation. So thank you, sir, for uniting our nation, calling us to prayer.
I just want to add that in our community, we have been praying. We started a 40-day fast for the healing of America and the sovereign protection of God. There's some things that we have to make, not diminishing your office, but in the view of a higher source. We've got to look to heaven. He will empower us, strengthen you, and give you wisdom.
And have a blessing.
Don't be shy, will you?
Since what are you shy? I'm not trying, Mr. President. Mr. President, this is a great moment. The country has a lot of challenges. You know that, Mr. President. To ask the country to turn back to God, to pray, is just an incredible thing for a president to do. I guess George Washington was the first one to do it. A lot of Americans may have forgotten that the country was built on a moral idea. In the second paragraph of the Declaration of Independence, I know you know it, all men are created equal, endowed by their creator, that's God, with certain inalienable rights, among these the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That's what makes us a shining city of the hill to hear the honored president of, and reminding the American people of that is an amazing thing.
Well, thank you very much. Sir. I appreciate it.
Anybody else? Anybody else?
Thank you, Mr. President.
From the beginning.
Yes, indeed. Thank you so much for your personal gift to the victims. I know Southern Baptists and evangelicals and people of all faiths and no faith are out there helping one another, and we appreciate your example. Going tomorrow to show presence. We call it something called ministry of presence. Sometimes it just means something to be there for people, and I appreciate you already having been there, and you're going again. I just deeply appreciate that. And it shows a connection with the people that is so needed. So I just personally want to say thank you.
Thank you.
On behalf of Southern Baptists in America.
Thank you.
Best of all.
I just thank you, sir, for calling our nation to God, and it's been an honor to not only know you for 16 years, but to serve with your faith leaders and to say that you always have put God first, and you challenge us and continue to challenge us as you lead us. We thank you for your personal works, and this, I believe, is a new beginning for us. But as we look forward, we are going to see great things come. Thank you for this unprecedented day. Thank you.
Yes.
Let's pray together, Nagel.
Yes.
Father, your word says, if your people who are called by your name will humble themselves and pray and seek your face, you will forgive their sins and heal their land. Father, I thank you that we have a president, President Donald Trump, who believes in the power of prayer. We thank you for our vice president, like Vice President Pence, who works alongside him. And we thank you that the president had the wisdom to call our nation right now for a day of prayer this coming weekend, Father. This is what we need. We pray for healing for our country.
Yes.
We pray for physical healing for those who have suffered the devastation from Hurricane Harvey, Father. Be with them. Provide for their needs. Help us to be the embodiment of Jesus Christ as we minister to them. But Father, we also want to pray for spiritual healing, emotional healing for our country. This country has been bitterly divided for decades upon decades, and now you have given us a gift. President Donald Trump, who wants to bring healing to this country, and he is bringing healing to this country, and I pray that you would give him and Vice President Pence the wisdom they need to truly make our country the country you want us to be. We want America to be great again, and we can know that America can only be great if this America is good, and we know we have a president who wants to make America good. I pray your blessing upon him, the First Lady, their family. Give them wisdom as they seek to honor you, and we pray this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who came and died and rose again, that we might have eternal life. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You know, I get blessed and shivers almost when they pray in the name of Jesus in such a public forum, because so many places they say, don't mention the name of Jesus, don't mention the name of God, don't mention, well, thank God his name is getting out there. And thank God that people You know, from what I saw, when I saw this, there was 1,100,000 viewed people that have already viewed it when I downloaded this. 83,000 likes. I haven't put out one yet on Facebook that I got that many likes. 24,067 shares, more than 3,000 comments. Most of them, many of the comments were very affirming and encouraging and appreciated what the call to prayer and so on. There were some very evil people. And I looked down the list of the comments and I chose some of those comments to share to back up. This is an illustration of what I just said. Evil people don't want God. They don't want God to tell them what to do. They don't want to talk to God. They don't want anything to do with God. They don't want the knowledge of God. Now look at some of these comments. Patrick Malone, right. This is sarcasm. Right. Because praying to an invisible being in the sky is really going to help. Lance Aquito, prayer for suffering people is the least you can do. That does nothing. Talking to an imaginary friend does not help others. This is what comments. Another comment, a day of prayer. Is Little Hands Trump going to be leading us in prayer? And then Salawa Maliki, which is obviously a Muslim, says, will this also include Muslim prayer? 7 million American Muslims would like that. Islam is the fastest growing religion in America, and it's expected to be a majority religion by 2100. Well, what he doesn't realize is lots of Muslims are coming to Jesus Christ. Now, they are having more babies than what most of us are having. But many Muslims around the world are coming to Christ. They don't count the fact that actually Christianity is the fastest growing religion in the world. So they don't have knowledge. They don't want that knowledge. But let's move on. Here's another one. Michael Mashahana, however you pronounce his name, should set aside another day of prayer for all those innocent men, women, and children who died in slavery under the bondage of the white European Caucasian devil. Many perished on the transatlantic voyage and were thrown out to sea and swallowed by sharks. Now, we could get in depth into discussing, he doesn't have much knowledge of what he's talking about. Why? Well, we can look at that a little bit more, but these people don't have the knowledge of God. They don't even have a true knowledge of history. Here's another one. So are we just going to do the whole separation of church and state thing? Like, do you guys want to follow the U.S. Constitution or no? I'm confused. Well, not really. I just know y'all are ignorant sheeple. The Constitution does not say that we cannot pray in public in the name of Jesus. It does not say that. Separation of church and state is not in the Constitution. Separation of church and state is not in the Constitution. You just read it from beginning to end. We have a separation that the government cannot interfere with the church. But it does not say to keep the church out of interfering or working with the government. And for years, President Jefferson and others attended church in the Capitol, of the United States Capitol, and attended services there every Sunday. And they started, the first Bible to be printed in America was printed by an act of Congress. So they ignore that. They don't want to know the real history of America because they want to distort it and come up with a brand new vision for America, not the vision of the founding fathers. And here's Rothschild, if some imaginary God is all-knowing and powerful, why did he let Hurricane Harvey happen? Well, maybe you needed it. Maybe this kind of attitude deserves people to see what happens when you ignore God.
That's right.
And you drive God out of your life.
That's right.
Or is it that he is an incompetent God? Either way, praying will not help anyone. The logic of adults. Santa Claus is more believable. These are some of the comments that come right after, down the line from when Mr. President made that application, made that announcement. And then here's another one. Oh, shut up, you insignificant, intolerable excuse for a compassionate human being. The world has been praying 24/7 since day one and will continue to do so as long as it takes. We do not need you to sign a bill. Your favorite thing because it makes you feel important. Your care, concern, and compassion is totally underwhelming. These are the kinds of attitudes of people responding to a call to prayer because they don't know God and they don't want to know God. This is a sad thing about it. These people mock the idea of prayer because they don't have knowledge, and they don't have knowledge because they do not want knowledge of the truth. Now let's look at what I read earlier. Evil people say, God, go away, depart from us, leave us alone. We don't want to know, have knowledge of your ways. And what profit do we have if we pray to him? These people are almost verbatim quoting the scripture. And and these are just some of the mild responses. I mean, there were some that were too vulgar that I wouldn't want to put up here anyway or repeat. But this is the attitude of people that don't want to know the truth. They don't want the knowledge of God. And God makes knowledge available to everyone. It's not just, well, I'll give you knowledge, but I won't give you it. If you want knowledge, God will make it available to you. In fact, Psalm 19 says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Day to day utters speech, and night to night reveals knowledge.
Jesus.
There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. God has made it publicly available for the world to know that he is God. And the kind of God he is our creator. And then as one of the men quoted, our founding fathers restated it when it said, we hold these truths to be self-evident. It's visible for everyone. It's evident for everyone that all are created equal and we're endowed by our creator with certain inalienable rights. Our founding fathers saw it was undeniable. It was evident. It was out there for the world to see. And if they don't see it, it's because they don't want to see it.
Yes.
They close their minds to it. Now, I hope none of us are guilty of that, but let's move on. Romans begins to talk about this very thing. And it just goes from bad to worse and worse and worse. But watch this. The wrath of God. God is angry about some things. It's revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress. That is, they hold down the truth. They want to cover up the truth in unrighteousness. Because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. He's made it visible for the world to see that he's God. He's the creator. How in the world could they tell us down to almost the second that we were going to have an eclipse, and then they could put it on the map, the path to the totality of the eclipse, and they could almost tell you to the minute when it was going to be happening to every spot along the way? How could they do that? Because God is a God of order, the creator who created all things and put it on exact timing.
That's right. Praise Jesus.
It just declares the glory of God. They're without excuse. Now, when you reject the knowledge of the Lord, you get on a descending, slippery slope that leads you to increasing evil perversions and will take you to hell. And when you start saying, no, I don't want to know God, I'm turned away from God, you're actually opening yourself up and your life up to the devil to take you down that trail. And it just keeps getting worse and worse. There are no limits, no breaks on that slide when you reject God. Because Romans 1:21-23, although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened, professing to be wise. These are some of our smart aleck professors in some of our universities and colleges that say there is no God. They're not wise, they're fools.
Exactly.
The Bible calls them fools. Because they refuse to see what is right in front of them. Professing to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. Therefore, God also gave them up. Said, okay, you want to go that way? Go on. It's your choice. One thing we need to remember is we have freedom of choice. We can make the wrong choices or the good choices, and it's up to us to make the right choices. And we can choose to do evil. And he gave them up because they refused to follow him. God gave them up, said, okay, go ahead. In the uncleanness, in the lust of their hearts, to dishonor their bodies among themselves. Who is exchanged the truth, this is the knowledge, the truth of the knowledge of God for the lie. And they worshiped and served the creature rather than the creator. They made gods out of people. They made gods out of stuff. They made gods out of trees and the sun and the moon and whatever. And they served the stuff that's been created rather than the creator who created it all. And worshiped and served the creature rather than the creator who is blessed. And for this reason, God gave them up to vile passions. For even the women exchange the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men, committing what is shameful, and receiving themselves the penalty of their error, which was due. God said, I have an order. I have a plan. You turn away from me, you're going to go follow your own plan, then you're going to go down that road that is going to be a road of destruction. Receiving to themselves the penalty of the error which was due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, remember we're talking about knowledge here, they didn't want God in their knowledge, they didn't want to know God. God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting. Being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness, they are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who knowing the judgments, the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but they also approve of those who do them or practice them. Are you seeing the picture? When you turn away from God and the knowledge of God and you choose to go the other way, you get on that, well, you could call it a descending ladder. Or what's one of those things that you step on in the airport that goes down?
Escalator.
Descending escalator. And it just keeps on going for the south. Down, 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 until finally you end up in the lake of fire. You're burned with fire and brimstone forever and ever. Because when you turn away from God, you're choosing a way that's going to destroy you.
Preach, Pastor.
That's the fact.
Preach, Pastor.
When you reject the knowledge of God and you choose the knowledge that the devil wants to give you, you begin to believe the lie, something's going to happen. Yes. And here's another verse. From Thessalonians, with all unrighteousness and deception, he's talking about the man of sin among those who perish because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned. King James says that they all may be damned who did not believe the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. When people turn away from the knowledge of the truth and the knowledge of God, and they start going the other direction, they're going the way the devil wants them to go. And that's to destroy them eternally in the lake of fire. And there comes a point when God says, because they reject the knowledge of the truth, they don't want to know the truth, rather they have pleasure in unrighteousness, because they want to do what they want to do, and they want to have fun doing their own sinful ways, and they turn away from the knowledge of God, God says, okay, you want, is that the way you want to go? Okay, go ahead and believe the lie. And he will allow them to be deluded.
My God.
And when they become deluded, then they're so confused, they don't know the truth. They don't know which is right, they don't know what's up, what's down, they don't understand what's, they're just so deluded that they're just swallowed up in the devil's lie. And at that point, they're on their way to eternal damnation. That's pretty serious stuff. Psalm 53 said, God looked down from heaven upon the children of men to see if there were any who understood, who seek God. Every one of them had turned aside. They have together become corrupt. There is none who does good. No, not one. Have the workers of iniquity no knowledge? Who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon God? He's saying the people that go down that road, it's like they don't know a thing. They have no knowledge. They're just no limits to what evil they can do. And I think, folks, if you really want to be serious and look around, you can see the condition of America. We've been going down that road.
That's right. That's right.
We've been going down that road. When we finally get a Supreme Court, and they've been trying for years to redefine marriage from what God intended, it's a big step towards eternal perdition for our nation. It's a big step towards that. And when we start trying to figure out, well, I was told I'm a man, but I think I'm a woman, so I'm going to use a women's restroom. And then the state and the president, the former president, and others say, okay, let them do whatever they want to do. If you come into this church, my friends, there's a sign over the ladies and a sign over the men's. Ladies will use the ladies, men will use the men's, and you don't cross over.
Amen.
But when there's so much confusion until they're telling little kids, well, your biological sex isn't really who you are, it's what you think you are, what you choose to be, and now they've got a guy they're showing who's actually married, has had children, and now he thinks he's a six-year-old girl.
Oh, my God.
And he's trying to identify as a six-year-old girl instead. What's gone wrong with America? They believe the lie. The delusion has taken place to destroy this nation because people have turned away from the knowledge of God. Now, Proverbs 1:22 says, how long, you simple ones, will you love simplicity? For scorners delight in their scorning, and fools hate knowledge.
Come on now.
It's no wonder God says, add knowledge to your virtue. Add knowledge to your faith. Add knowledge. Learn to know some things for true, for real. Yeah. Really know them.
Yes.
So that people can't confuse you by the lies they tell you.
That's right. That's it right.
And so Solomon was the person that was the second king after he was David's son and he became king. And after he had dedicated the temple, after he had prayed and he was now the king, God said to him, Solomon, ask me whatever you want and I'll give it to you.
Yes, Jesus.
Ooh, wouldn't that be great?
God. Yes, Lord.
What would you say? Jesus. Oh, God, I've been wanting a Lamborghini. That would be totally stupid.
No.
Lamborghini? What are you going to do with that? Just go off and show off and run off on a big tech pride tangent? Look out when you don't have no way to buy the tags? Well, I want $1 million. You'd probably blow that overnight because you don't know how to spend it. But what would you ask God? Well, Solomon did the right thing. And so here's what he said, 2 Chronicles 1:7. Now, Lord, give me wisdom and knowledge that I may go out and come in before this people. For who can judge this great people of yours? And notice what God was so happy with Solomon's choice for knowledge and wisdom that God said to Solomon, because this was in your heart, and you've not asked riches or wealth or honor or the life of your enemies, nor have you asked long life for yourself, but you've asked for wisdom and knowledge for yourself, that you may judge my people over whom I've made you king. Now wisdom and knowledge are granted to you.
Yes.
I'm going to give you wisdom and knowledge.
Jesus.
And I will give you riches and wealth and honor, such as none of the kings have had who were before you, nor shall any after you have the like. God saying, because you made the right choice for knowledge and wisdom, I'm going to bless you with all these other blessings. They're going to be added. That goes sort of along with the scripture that Jesus said when he said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these things will be added. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's what Solomon was doing, and God blessed him for seeking wisdom. Solomon wrote the Proverbs, my son, if you receive my words and treasure my commandments within you, so that you incline your ear to wisdom and apply your heart to understanding it. Yes, if you cry out for discernment and lift up your voice for understanding, if you seek her as silver and search for her as hidden treasures, I mean, if you really value it that much, that it's sort of like you're gold mining, you're trying to find something of real value, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. It comes by having a heart for God that says, God, I want to know you. I want to walk with you. I want to serve you. I want to know what pleases you. I want to know. I want that kind of knowledge, God. For God, the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. And he stores up sound wisdom for the upright. He's a shield for those who walk uprightly. So, shall we add knowledge?
Yeah.
Let's add knowledge. Let's learn. Now, there's several scriptures. Now, I'm not sure I'm going to have much time for this, but maybe I'll rush it through. Remember last Sunday I told you about that very unjust thing that happened to my wife and me when we first went to New Guinea, and how we were mistreated, and the vehicle that was bought for me was taken, given to somebody else, and I ended up walking miles, and we were destitute out there in the jungles without a vehicle to get even to the hospital and so on. And, well, let me tell you a little bit of the rest of the story. After we overcame the trial so that we didn't get bitter and angry and mad at the people and so on, We were out there, my wife and I, we were running low on food. And late one night, we saw the lights of a vehicle coming down the road. Now, the last mile of the road we built, the last mile of that road, we built it ourselves. It was our own road, our mission road, so no vehicles came down there unless they were coming to see us. So we see this vehicle coming, and my wife said, what are we going to feed them? They're going to have to spend the night, and we don't have any food to feed them. And so the truck pulls up, and I go out to greet whoever it is, and the fellow that was driving the truck said, hey, give me a hand, I've got some bags of stuff to bring in. And I went out there, and we started carrying in bags of groceries.
Yes, Lord.
That the Lord delivered in the night.
Yes, Lord, won't we do it?
And we didn't have the food. We didn't have the way to go get food.
Come on now.
And God brought in a truckload of groceries for us to meet our need. And then eventually we got a vehicle and we were able to take care of coming and going. And then we got to the hospital and Rowena was having some serious complications. And 4 o'clock in the morning, that morning I was awake praying and God whispered into my mind and said, everything's going to be all right.
Yes, Lord.
You carry the comfort. So I go over to the hospital, the doctor comes out and he's actually wringing his hands. He said, I've induced labor, but things aren't right. He said, this isn't right. Things are going bad. He said, I've ordered a plane to fly you all to the nearest town that has a gynecologist, and there's a doctor there from Australia, and somebody's standing by to give blood, and we're gonna send you down. So we go out in an ambulance. I didn't have time to go back and pick up a suitcase or any clothes or anything. We just jumped in the ambulance, headed for the plane. He sent a nurse along, we get in the plane, and we're flying down, and the air currents are so bad, that plane is just bouncing up and down until the nurse got sick in the plane. Maybe God was using that, because by the time we got to the hospital, the gynecologist did the checkup. She said, everything's okay. You're going to have this baby naturally.
Yeah.
And I was able to tell my wife, even in the middle of all that, God said, you're going to be okay. Everything's going to be fine. And it was. And that night, about 10 o'clock, the young lady, Wendy, was born. And we were so excited. I didn't have any suitcase. I didn't have a place to sleep. And the nurse said, that's okay. My husband's going to come pick me up in a little bit and you come spend the night with us.
Yes.
And so God was taking care of us. And then I get a call from a letter from the board, the home board back here, that said, we have just appointed you to be the director of the whole field of Papua New Guinea.
Yes.
So I also got a promotion. And then we were able to plant the first town church that EBM had planted in the city in the country of Papua New Guinea. It was in the town of Mindi. And God opened the door for us to plant churches. We saw some great things happening that God was doing.
Yeah.
Well, let me move on quickly. Then Rowena got sick with hepatitis. And the doctor said, you better go home because you're not going to recover well over here. So we came back to the States early in 1974. And that EBM director that I talked about before, he totally turned against me. He didn't want anything, even though I'd been the field director, he started spreading rumors, he started doing things. And so when we came to the next board meeting, I was praying. I spent a lot of time praying and seeking God for wisdom. What do I do, Lord? What's my answer? Do I go on serving? And I came to the conclusion that I could only serve if I could respect my leader, because the Bible says, obey those who are in authority over you. And if I couldn't, I had another option, that was to step aside, to resign, which I did before the board. And the board accepted my resignation, and I slipped out not knowing where we were going, but God called us out to Tioga, Louisiana, where we pastored for a little while my wife was recovering from hepatitis, and then I started getting calls to come preach in churches all over America. And so we eventually started as an evangelist all over America, preaching in churches and traveling. And that went on. We also spent 6 months in Guyana, South America as a missionary, helping to relieve a missionary who had to come back to the States for an operation. And I helped to get some of the people in Bible college through that year, that semester, and that year of schooling, and then graduate them and ordain them into the ministry. And one of those guys is up in New York. He's pastoring a church up there, a thriving church in New York, that was one of those people that we had the privilege of touching down there and helping to call it into the ministry and usher them in the ministry. And then the old EBM director resigned. And then I got a call from the board saying, Would you consider going back to New Guinea? Well, I hadn't burned any bridges. I hadn't gone out slandering people.
Uh-huh.
I hadn't gone on a war path saying, oh, those people are so evil, that director's wicked, he's bad, look what he's done. I just didn't do that because that's not the wisdom that God was giving me. And so the door was wide open for me to go back to Papua New Guinea. So in 1979, we went back to Papua New Guinea, and I was chosen to be the field director again. We began planting city churches. God blessed us in marvelous ways. Then in 1984, the board called me and said, Gerald, would you consider being the leader of EBM? I said, no, I don't want to be that. I want to go back to New Guinea. But after we prayed and considered it, and I had some people say, please, you better, hopefully you'll take that position. We accepted the position in 1984 as the president of EBM. And then we've discovered that the former director, the one that had been love you one minute, hate you the next, he had a brain tumor and cancer that was affecting his mood swings.
Wow.
And so he had a physiological reason for why he was what he was. And before he died, I visited him in the hospital to let him know that all was forgiven, that I had nothing against him. And he passed on.
Jesus.
Went to his reward. And I'm sure that a lot of the stuff he was doing, he wasn't responsible for because of his brain problems that he was having that we didn't know. He just looked like a mean, ugly old man. And it'd be easy to judge people that way, but the wisdom that God gives us is the wisdom of kindness, the wisdom of love, the wisdom of patience, the wisdom to understand that we don't know the whole picture of what's going on in people's lives. Are you guys with me?
Yes.
Come on, kids, wake up and say amen now and then.
Amen.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And so God is calling us to add knowledge and wisdom.
Yes, Lord.
To the virtue.
Yes, Lord.
The character that God wants us to have.
Yes, Lord.
And when we follow God and do that, God says, just keep on adding knowledge. And Peter, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and forever.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
God's calling us to just add some knowledge. Don't be an ignoramus. Don't be a fool. Add knowledge. Learn the stuff that God wants us to learn. Learn to know him. Learn to know his ways. And you get that by studying the Bible, studying the Word of God. 1 Timothy 2:15, study and be eager. This is from the Amplified. And do your utmost to present yourself to God approved, tested by trial, a workman who has no cause to be ashamed, correctly analyzing and accurately dividing and rightly handling and skillfully teaching the word of truth. So God is asking us, study the Bible. Learn what it says. Understand the heart of God as he reveals it to us through his word. Acquire knowledge. Add knowledge to virtue. Are we in for it? Are we going to do it? Let's add knowledge. Let's learn all we can learn about God and his ways and his attitude. Now, as I said before, the rest of the story, it ain't over yet, but I'll show you some more of my own story. But God promises us if we will do his way, if we'll accept what he offers us, he's given us all things that pertain to life and godliness, we will be victorious. And we can end this race in life like Paul did. I have come to the end. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. And I'm looking for a crown of life. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, now here's a song that some of us used to sing, and it just kind of wraps it up. I'm gonna close up with this one. From Psalm 86. Unto thee, O Lord. Sing it all.
Do I lift up my soul unto thee, O Lord? Do I lift up my soul, O my God? I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let mine enemies triumph over me.
Here's one.
Those that wait on the Lord and follow him,
they won't be ashamed. you know it is yours. Let's have prayer together, and we're going to close and let you go. But don't forget, there's food over here on this side. As you go out, take some for yourself and your family, and take some along for other people that need it. And God bless you. Let's go out to keep adding what God has for us. Father, thank you for your word. It's a book of instruction where you teach us your thoughts and your mind and your will and your wisdom. And Lord, we ask you, teach us your will. Show us and give us the knowledge of God, that we might know you more and more, that we might please you, that we might know what you want from us and how we can live and how we can act and what you want us to be and do. Lord, we want to be restored to the image of God. We want the image of Christ to be formed in us so that other people see you when they see us. Let your glory fill the tabernacles of our bodies, our temples, these temples of the Holy Spirit. And help us to go out into the workplace, into the world outside, to show Jesus to that world. We pray and ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.